Okay, now we have had some integrated milk tea and can continue in a coordinated manner. Okay, we are talking about customer relations. Another issue in customer relations or patient relations in healthcare is the question of choice, patient choice. We had the other day the discussion about the power gap, and we observed that in healthcare there is the information asymmetry, and from this follows that in certain situations certain patients are not endowed, or it's not possible for them to make rational choices like they do as customers in any other sort of commercial market. So you have the choices constrained by urgency or pain or confusion or anxiety or lack of knowledge or understanding and so on and so forth. But nevertheless, there is this issue of patient choice that happens in healthcare, and it's considered important in those areas where you don't have this sort of emergency kind of constraints. So for example, in Finland, the government has initiated a program for expanding patient choice. So previously it has been that the system has been tax financed and publicly managed, so you are assigned to a health center depending on where you live. So in the same way as you have been assigned to, your kids are assigned to a school depending on your address. So you have school districts, and everybody who lives in that area, they go to that school. In the same way, everybody who lives in that area go to that doctor. But that is not necessarily very smart, because it creates a sort of local monopolies, which are bad for efficiency. So now the government has decided to go for new rules where you can choose. So there's patient choice. So that's why there's been a lot of discussion and debate on this. And also with co-creation and patient empowerment, the question of under what conditions can a patient choose rationally, and where which are the areas where choice can be allowed and where can it not be allowed, is it's rather central. So I think basic constellation here is that as a patient you have two choices, or two kinds of choices. The first one is the choice of caregiver. So that is, where do you go? Which doctor do you see? Which hospital, which clinic, which GP do you see? The choice of caregiver in emergencies is typically restricted, because you want to go to the nearest or the best suited, and that decision is many times taken by the ambulance crew. But in other issues, we can say that the choice of caregiver by and large is a consumeristic choice. So choose your doctor in the same way as you choose your grocery shop or your barber or beauty salon or whatever services. And there's been tons of research in marketing about how people choose, but typically it's proximity, so you go to the place which is nearby and most convenient. You go to a place that is familiar to you, and particularly so in healthcare, people want to see the same doctor, even if they have to travel a little bit. Then your accumulated experience. If you have good experience from going to one shop or one place, then you keep going there. If you have bad experience, or somebody tells you about bad experiences, then you might change your mind, and so on and so forth. So this is not complete. This is like in any kind of business. The other aspect is then the choice of care. So once you have choice, the hospital or the doctor, and then comes the question of what should be done. And now it's good, important to remember these two choices are very, very different. So information asymmetry and knowledge gap or power gap applies mostly to the choice of care, not to the choice of care. The choice of care is sort of constrained by bounded rationality or information asymmetry. It's also constrained by cost. The because if you choose care, there is a sort of potential choice dimension, which is the level of specialization. The level of specialization means that on the lowest level you have, let's say, an ASHA worker who is not necessarily a professional. Then you might have a janitor in the hospital who knows something. You can have a nurse, you can have a qualified registered nurse, you can have a GP, junior doctor, a senior GP, a specialist, a high-level specialist, a super specialist, and mega super top-notch international superstar in sort of one line of work. Now, which one of these do you choose? Well, if you have free choice, then of course everybody always goes for the superstar. There are no one Indian superstar. He is very famous, Devi Shetty. You know him? No, who is Devi Shetty? Yeah.
Very famous in India.
Yeah. Okay, so famous. You also know. You don't have a cardiac problem, but you know him. Yeah. Devi Shetty is the boss of the Narayana Hyrdala system in Bangalore. I've been there a couple of times. Did a piece of research comparing Narayana and Helsinki University. I'll tell about it later. But it's a fascinating place. I mean, people come from all over the world to see Devi Shetty. The man, the individual. And he's quite an impressive guy. I remember when we and a couple of colleagues went to Narayana Hyrdala and we managed to get an appointment with Devi Shetty to talk about some management issues related to Narayana and the research we were doing. And we went to the top floor where his office is. It was a huge big office and a lot of this kind of secretary servants are going, oh, come this way. Now you go there, sit there. He's coming soon. And we sit there waiting. And trying, where is he coming? He's coming somewhere. And all of a sudden, because we're sitting in front of his desk was here. Sitting there in front of the desk and expecting him to come from the door. But he appeared from behind the desk because there was a curtain where there is a hidden door directly to his operating room. And he comes there with the surgeon's gowns and the cap and little blood on the hands and okay, what do you guys want? So he looked, it was really scary because I can understand he's a charismatic guy. I don't know if you have seen the movie Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom. And it's prohibited in India, I think. But there is the bad guy looks like Devi Shetty, so he's a sort of little bit scary guy. But he was very impressive as a person. I mean, he's running a huge hospital, 5,000 beds, big business, but he's doing patient work all the time. And that's why he has his office where he's doing the management job, and then he has his operating theater just next door. So he goes back and forth. He operates on people's hearts, and then he leaves it there, and he goes to the office, and he's running the business and doing whatever, meeting visitors, and then he goes back there and doing patient work 16 hours a day. Okay, so that's about Devi Shetty. I mean, there are these kind of charismatic people in all industries. Like everybody knows Bill Gates and Steve Jobs, but in cardiac surgery, Devi Shetty is the Steve Jobs kind of character. Very impressive. But anyway, so people would obviously always, if you have a sort of free, unlimited choice, you would go for the superstars. But that cannot be allowed, because there are very few of these kind of superstars, and they are very expensive. And the government would not pay for that, the insurance company would not pay for that, and most of us couldn't afford to pay it out of pocket. So there has to be some kind of rules and regulations on what is the sort of specialization level that you encounter in different kind of situations. So free choice between a superstar and the ASHA worker is not typically sort of allowed. It cannot be free choice. It's economically constrained choice. And in Europe, or in countries where health finance is mostly tax-based, the government pays out of the tax base. And that's why the government has a say on to what kind of resources are used. So from this follows there is a thing called the Alma-Ata principle. Alma Ata is, where is it? It's located in former Soviet Union. Anyway, sometimes in the 1970s there was a big World Health Organization conference in Alma Ata, and I think it's 1976, and they published a declaration called as the Alma Ata Declaration, and part of that declaration that lined up certain kind of basic principles for global healthcare was the principle that the care should be given at the lowest reasonable or sufficient level. Not higher than that. You should go to the lowest specialization level that is sort of good enough for you. Now, people tend to go to a higher level, but the governments or the insurance companies would not allow that. So Alma Ata says that this is justified and it should be taken as a policy. When we talk about healthcare that is financed by the government or insurance companies or other people's money. If you pay your own money, then you can go wherever you want, no limitations. So so that's the thing with the choice of care and the level of care. So typically, you have the gatekeeping function there. In Finland, as in most countries, if you want to go to a specialist care hospital, you cannot just walk in. You have to get a referral from a general practitioner. They send you there, and then they look at it. You can go in there only if you are an emergency case. This picture has been screwed up in the transmission. This is supposed to be a sort of pie with three equal parts. I don't know what happened with the PowerPoint, but anyway, three equal parts of a pie. Okay, so correct it with a pen in your material. This is. Yeah, this is an interesting summary of a set of research that's done by an American professor called John Wenberg. It's published in a very interesting book called Tracking Medicine, Researchers' Quest to Understand Modern Medicine. It's very worthwhile reading if you are interested in a particular topic. So John Wenberg studied the question of what is a relation between supply and demand in healthcare. So what determines the demand and is there a connection between supply and demand? And this he says that if you think of all the things that doctors do, then one third is evidence-based. Evidence-based medicine. It means that what the doctor is doing is based on hard evidence from clinical medicine, based on things that he studied in medical school, things that have been proved by this random controlled trials and published in medical journals. So it's a sort of scientifically based things. So one third. Then the second third, according to Johan Wenberg, is preference and choice-based medicine. And by this he means situations where a patient has a medical problem, something needs to be done, but the medical sciences cannot exactly say that this and only this is the thing that needs to be done. So medical sciences can say that, okay, there are two or three options. We don't know, nobody can know which of them is better. So how do you decide? Well, most typically the patient can choose. And in many of these kind of situations you have difficult trade-offs. It's a bit of a nasty story, but because it's a little bit personal, because I haven't yet, but may have to make these kind of choices when it comes to prostate cancer. I don't have it, but my father had it, so maybe sometimes I get it. So with prostate cancer, typically if you get the diagnosis, then the options are, starting from the heaviest side, is invasive surgery, which means that they go into your private parts and they cut off something and take out the tumor and we hope that that cures it. But the operation goes into very sensitive parts of the human body, from which follows that, and every human being have little bit different nerves and blood vessels and things going on. So there is a rather high risk that something happens during the intervention, which leaves damage. So substantial amount of patients who have been operated for prostate cancer, they recover and cancer is gone, but they have to use diapers the rest of their life because they cannot keep the urine, or they lose their male potential. So that's a sort of a nasty trade-off, where you have to think, okay, if you go for the operation, then you reduce the probability that you will die out of prostate cancer. And but nobody can give you an exact figure, but even if you can, then if your probability of you dying in prostate cancer before age of 80, that goes down 20%. At the same time, you have 42.5% risk of sustaining some kind of damage during the surgical procedure. Now, sir, make your choice. How easy is that? Not easy at all. I mean, it's a very nasty situation, and it is even more nasty because nobody can give you sort of the exact probabilities. And even if they could, there are still probabilities. If you could say that it's 100% sure that without these operations you are going to die in prostate cancer before age of 80. If you could say 100%, then the situation would be clear. But no doctor ever would say 100%, because that kind of knowledge is not available in the world. They would say 70%, 40%. So the choice, in any case, is very difficult. And for prostate cancer, it's very well known that some of the strains are aggressive, some are not. So if you check the dead bodies of all the gentlemen and do the biopsy, then almost everybody has prostate cancer. But it's not necessarily the cause of death. So that's why a viable option to the invasive surgery is what is known as watchful waiting. Just monitor the condition and keep an eye on the situation, and if it turns bad, then come back. But so far, no need to do anything. And then in some cases there are some medications that can be taken, or some lifestyle related things that can be improved. So you have basically three options. And each of these options, the invasive surgery, watchful waiting, and medication, have different sort of risk-benefit profiles. So the decision situation is rather complex. And as I said, no doctor will, in his or her right mind, would sort of try to force any kind of choice on the patient in normal conditions. So it's left to the patient. And then it depends if you are risk averse, or what kind of life do you live. I mean, if you're an active person and do sports or something, the idea that you'd have to use diapers to keep your pants clean for the rest of your life, horrible idea. So I would accept the risk of dying a little sooner rather than going for that option, right? But somebody else who is sitting at home watching TV all the day, then what's the problem? Doesn't make a big deal in your life if you have diapers or not. So these decisions are not necessarily medical anymore. They're based on your life, your preferences, your conditions at home, your family, all these kind of things. And non-medical things that have an impact on about one-third of the things that doctors do. And then the last slice of this pie, the last third, is what is known as supply-driven demand. And that's a nasty part of it. So Jon Benvenberg, he describes in big detail many studies have been done in various parts of the United States. For example, if
you have a medium-sized city, and then there comes a new hospital that introduces the magnetic resonance imaging cameras, or MRIs. So there is a supply of diagnostic services. So all of a sudden, very soon, the demand changes, and everybody and his dog start to want an MRI. And the kind of diseases that people have changed because the MRI camera discovers some subclinical things that nobody knew about or cared about before. So the supply creates its own demand. Of course, that happens in any business. So if, in the same way as we discussed the airline companies, if the air travel supply increases and all of a sudden you have cheap flights from here to Goa, then people start to want to have them. Or if Steve Jobs and Apple come up with a smartphone with touchscreen, then the supply changes our behavior and we all start to demand, you know, the internet-enabled phones, and we cannot live without them. 10 years ago, we didn't even know what they were, but now we cannot live up. So in that sense, supply always creates its own demand. But in healthcare, the situation is a little bit nasty because in most cases you don't pay with your own money. It's taxpayers' money or it's insurance money. So is it wise then to increase the supply to create demand that would not create good outcomes or any value in society? So that's a fundamental moral question here. And so what is disturbing a little bit here is that according to Jon Wennberg, 1/3 of the things that doctors do is of this character. Now, please remember this is United States, not India. So India still has, as we have mentioned, 200 million people who get no healthcare, so there is no supply, there is demand but no supply. So in a country like India, I think this constellation certainly must be different, and it's valid only in a small segment of Indian society for the very rich people who can afford these kind of things. But nevertheless, this phenomenon is there. As I said earlier about the power gap, the seller sells promises and value propositions. And because a lot of the trade in healthcare is about value propositions, not sort of real demonstrated things, then you can have this very big effect of supply creating demand, and that can have bad consequences. For example, we have had these health policy debates in Finland, and several of the health economists have created quite a scandal by saying that if you would cut the current healthcare spend into half, the current healthcare spend in Finland per capita is something like a little under 4,000 euros per year, which is a lot. If you would cut half of that, then what would happen? And the answer is nothing. Not much. I mean, half of the capacity would go away. The estimated impact on public health would be very small. The main impact would come from the fact that old and very sick people would die 2 or 3 months earlier than what they do today. And that comes from the fact that if you think of the health spend over the lifetime of an individual in the rich countries, 80% of everything you spend on healthcare is spent during the last 2 months of your life. Of course, if you are hit by a truck and you get expensive emergency care and you die, then this happens to you. But very few people die at a young age these days. In advanced countries, most of people die at very old age. So the money that is spent during the last 2 months of life is most of the time completely wasted, because the people die anyway. If they die 1 month sooner or later, does it really care? At the same time, when the money is typically spent on on useless, fruitless, very expensive intensive care, emergency treatments, hospitalization, what not, that is not sort of a dignified way for a human being to die. Drugged up and hooked up in machines in a hospital where there are strangers all around, you know. So this is what happens in healthcare easily, that you create situations that are extremely expensive without creating very much value. So that's funny. But anyway, so the point here is to say that because there is such a sort of big slice of things going on in healthcare that are patient preference driven, then the sort of customer relations or the patient relations in healthcare are sensitive, and they need to be managed in many ways. Randomized controlled trial. So it's the gold standard of testing. Okay, so then these different choice constellations have been studied, but maybe we don't elaborate on that anymore. And okay, so this is the summary of customer relations per DSO. You can say that the relationship is structured differently in these different DSOs. And some of these they are ongoing, like in prevention, but in emergencies, at least you hope that it's random, one at a time. There is no sort of logical continuity. It's random. If you are taken to emergency several times over, they're typically sort of discrete events. So to sum it up, we say that the customer relations can be structured along the question whether they are continuous or they are random. And then the kind of choices that are involved, and what are the sort of the choice parameters that are relevant for different people in different situations. But anyway, if you ever get in a position where you have to manage a hospital or a healthcare service production unit, then the patient relation department is an essential part of the whole sort of concept. It cannot be ignored. All right. So the next box. Now we jump a little bit here to the other side of the box. I'll talk about the customer channels later on, because I think this makes a sort of logical sequence to go to the key activities at this point. The key activities, that's operations management, really. The rest of this has been business model thinking that draws on marketing and strategy and finance and many kinds of sciences. But key activities are by and large operations management. So we have to look into that side. So in key activities, I think the basic setup we have already mentioned is that in managing processes, whether in manufacturing or services, there are two dimensions, the flow efficiency and the resource efficiency. And this in manufacturing, the flow efficiency is typically measured by the throughput time. So how much time does it take for one product to move through the system from the beginning to the end? And the throughput time is related then mainly to in working progress or inventory costs. This line of thinking in industrial management emerged in Japan long time ago at the time when interest rates were very high. And today interest rates are low, close to zero in most part of the world. But there was a time in history where interest rates typically were 10% or something. So in that kind of environment, you don't want to have a lot of inventory in the system because you have to finance the inventory through working capital, which is expensive. Do you understand this logic? The cost of inventory. What is the cost of keep having inventory? What's the logic behind that?
The resources are not being used now, so we are not getting any revenue from that.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the two aspects, yeah, that one and that one, right. So if you think of a manufacturing plant, where you build mobile phones or cars or whatever. So in order to start doing something, you have to buy the components and the raw materials, and you have to pay your electricity bill, and you have to pay your labor, and all that. So while you start building the product, So you have expenses and costs accumulate all the time. You put components here, you do paint jobs, you spend electricity, you run the drills, blah, blah, blah. And so your cost is accumulate. You have to pay your bills all the time. Where do you get the money? Well, you get the money when you sell the stuff. But depending on what you sell, you might get the money then, you know, 2 weeks later or 40 days later, depending on what is the sort of time limit when your customers pay the bill. Mm-hmm. So that creates a situation where you spend money here, but you get money here. Yeah, that's the economic cycle times. So the revenues come in here, but you have to pay your bills for the same unit already here. So that creates a gap. And unless you are extremely rich and you have a lot of cash in your company, you have to finance this part somehow to pay your bills while you are waiting for the money to come in. Now, if you have ongoing operations where you sell 10,000 cars every day, then it evens out. But if you have, let's say, a shipyard, where you sort of build a ship for 2 years, and then it could be paid when you deliver it, then you have to live 2 years on borrowed money. So in that sense, the inventory carrying cost is a significant and important thing. And as you said, depending on the industry, you have to carry you have to have a warehouse. You have to have some kind of inventory tracking system. You have to keep track of the stuff. And like say in the agribusiness, some of the stuff is perishable. So you cannot store it for longer than a few weeks, or you need to have refrigerated storages. Milk products cannot be stored anyway. What is the limit, by the way? Milk.
4 days.
Yeah. So 4 days is maximum limit. And then if you have keep it more than 4 days, you have to throw it away.
So timing is prepared from the farmer and delivered to the customer in the packaged milk.
Yeah. 4 days. Yeah. So different products. And the same is true in metal components, they can rust. Or electronics can go bad. And in fast moving industries, you know, they get old. Like processors and memories, you know, they become old-fashioned because new products keep coming out. So having an inventory is a costly affair, and that's why the idea in industrial management, sometimes in the 1970s, 80s, because of the Japanese impact, shift from resource efficiency to flow efficiency. That earlier the main idea was resource efficiency, meaning that you look at every machine and every production line and every person, and you look at the capacity utilization rate, because the resources should be utilized with maximum efficiency. And from this follows, even in labor management and even in universities, the idea that you should keep working. If you sit in the library and study, by the way, so you have to pretend to do something, So if you take a nap while you study, then your professors and things, oh, this guy is not doing anything. Why? It comes from the old-fashioned things that resources should be moving and working all the time. If you keep working all the time, then you'll get rich and good things happen to you, and everything will be well. But in many instances, particularly in intellectual work, that is a false notion. It's not true. It's a thinking fallacy. And in industry, it was discovered that, okay, you keep the machine utilization rates and labor utilization maximum high, but what happens? You create bottlenecks in production, you have inventory pileups, you create a lot of complicating balancing problems, there are too much of that and too little of this, the whole place becomes a chaos, and throughput times becomes very long, and you are punished by very high inventory carrying costs. So all the machines work 100%, people work 100%, and you lose money. So that was the sort of the observations that disturbed the sort of normal view of industrial management back in the 1970s. So how can this be true? We are doing all things right, and still we are losing money. So that those observations that didn't fit the model caused a paradigmatic change. So now we need to have a better model that explains what happens. That explains that you are doing all the right things, but still you are not making money. And the new thing, which is known as the lean production paradigm, says that it's not enough to have top resource efficiency. You also need to have the flow efficiency. Now these are two different things. They behave differently, but they are interconnected. So if you want to make money and be successful, you have to have a reasonable and sufficient balance between flow and resource efficiency. And as I said earlier, to manage only one of these is easy. Because one set of key performance indicators, you have one set of tools and methods and incentives you use, but when you have to do two things at the same time, it becomes difficult. So there's a joke that many people cannot do two things simultaneously or keep two things in the mind at the same time, particularly if these two things are contradictory. So that's one, by the way, one definition of high intelligence. That you can keep two things in your mind at the same time, even though these two things are contradictory to each other. For some other people, it's too much a challenge to ride a bicycle and chew a gum at the same time. Okay, so that's. You mean by linear that when one increases, the other increases in the same amount. So you're thinking of this dotted line here.
Yes.
Well, that's just to illustrate. The ideal, of course, would be that if you improve flow efficiency, you would at the same time improve resource efficiency. And if you improve resource efficiency, you would have also an improvement in the flow efficiency. But the problem is that there's no automatic linear relationship here. It's an ideal model. So you would want to be up there in upper right corner, because that's a place where you make money and you are successful and do good things. But it's easy to, you might end up in the down right corner or up there left, where you are good in one aspect, like the factories in the 70s, resource efficiency is good, but flow efficiency is very, very bad. So there, the question is now that in what instances are the trade-offs between flow and resource efficiency? And what instances can you break that trade-off? So now as we discussed a minute ago, about the Emperor of Japan and his floor at the Tokyo University Hospital. And that is sort of flow efficiency maximization operation. So it, but it serves the flow efficiency need of the emperor's family. If something happens, they will immediately get everything, and the flow, the patient journey for the emperor is as good as money can buy. But they get this with a heavy sacrifice on resource efficiency. Most of the time the resources stand there on standby, nothing happened, money goes out of the system, nothing is done. You see the point. So in some instances you have a trade-off. But the question is, if you think of I started to think about De Vicetti's hospital, which is quite a good example of how you can say at the same time improve flow and resource efficiency. So you devise the patient journey and the process in such a way that things happen in a coordinated way. So the patient flow goes nice. And at the same time, the people who are processing the patient as a sort of daily schedule, which gives you a high capacity utilization. You know, so these two things needs to be looked after at the same time. It can be done, but it doesn't come easily, and it depends on what you are talking about, because every sort of production system has its different logical production and cost structure and all that. So the trick of trade is to somehow get these two things into order. So, if you want to get the key performance indicators on resource efficiency, then that is quite easy to get the numbers, because you have the resource. The resources usually can be identified. So you have a person, individual who's working, you have a machine that works, you have a room that is occupied or not occupied, right? So just collect the numbers. You have a person working, and the labor hours that they pay for is 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, right? 40 hours a week. Then you just look at that guy, follow him around, and you check, is he working? Yes or no? How many minutes will work? And then you can apply, of course, this, like in the patient in progress, a sort of direct patient work, diagnostic work, administrative work, this and that kind of work. Thinking work, whatever. So if you talk about professionals, it's difficult to make distinction when you are thinking and when you are sort of doing. But if you are manual labor, let's say nurses, then you can quite easily see when they are doing something valuable and when they are not doing. So you just check that, your stopwatch, and you have a number. And aggregate them, and you get the capacity utilization rate of each resource. And you are in business. You have the numbers, and then you can start managing. So I believe perhaps the epistemological ease that is associated with resource efficiency probably explains why in the history of industrial management the resource efficiency was the first thing that people start to talk about. The epistemology of flow efficiency is a little bit more complicated. And that takes us to the question of production processes. So the process is again one of these plain, ordinary English words that everybody believes they know what it is, but very few people sort of understand all the kinds of processes are. So the process means a number of things. And as such, it is sort of, you can think of it as a sort of general concept, like the bird. But in the real life, you always have certain kind of sort of specific processes that are configured in certain ways, and they have different characteristics. But on the sort of bird level, general level, we can say that the process, the production process, is a coordination device. It's sort of intellectual device in the sense that, I mean, again, in the same sense as we talked about the double entry bookkeeping a while ago. It doesn't exist in the world. It's an abstract concept. In the world, what you see is money coming and going. In the world, you see things happening and not happening. The process is a sort of intellectual frame that you use in order to understand what's happening in more exact and precise ways, so that you can take measures and identify different parts of it. So the typical production process, you can say, is a sequence of steps. So you have discrete steps that are more or less specialized, and they happen in a certain kind of order. So the sequence is one important thing. There is, in some issues, there is a very importantly, certain things needs to be done first, and then some other things, and then some other things. So some issues in this world are extremely sequence dependent, like, for example, surgery. Typically, you do the anesthetics first, and then you cut the person. Would you like to change the order? No, that would not be advisable. You know, so you have a sort of fixed sequence that cannot be easily changed. But then in other instances, if you do, say, physiotherapy or patient interviews, then it doesn't really matter what the order is. But the same is true in many instances. For example, if you study world history, then you can start from modern times and go backwards towards ancient times, or you start from ancient world and go back to modern. Or you can jump in the middle and specialize on medieval times or whatever. But if you study mathematics, then you have to follow certain kind of sequence, because the different aspects of mathematics build on each other. And if you don't understand the basics, then you cannot go further. So you have a sort of sequence dependency, or path dependency, is in some things and not in others. Then we have this thing of division of labor that we just discussed. The steps typically have some kind of level of specialization and standardization. A process typically is a set of dedicated resources that is designed for certain kind of purposes. So like the, what I mentioned, the stroke process at Helsinki University Hospital, it's a set up where there are certain kind of equipments lined up in a certain kind of way, and there are certain kind of people with certain skill sets that are assigned to that process, and it's activated in a certain way. And these assets cannot be used to anything else. In that sense, it's highly specialized. This is the technical term for this is asset specificity. It's an important concept in microeconomics. Do you have production assets that can be used only for one purpose or for several purposes? So the stroke line is a single purpose set of assets. An ordinary operating room typically can be used for many different kind of things, but then you might have sort of specialized operating rooms that do only, say, neurosurgery, because they need different kind of equipment and settings and stuff. So that's one more thing. Then the important thing in processes is the handovers and the inventory. So if you have a production process with discrete steps, then there is always a gap between the steps. And it's the gap that typically is difficult to manage. Because in the gap, you have inventory. So work in progress, patient in progress. The first step is accomplished, and then you are there waiting for the next to begin. So what happens in there between? That's the question. You are sort of an inventory. No value is added. Time is consumed, expenses accumulate. So it's the gaps that are important. And it's the gaps that needs to be bridged by control information. That's where the IT systems come in. So in a sense, you could, if you look at this picture, you could envision as a neural system. You know, the nerves in a human body or in the brain, they are these kind of cells that have all these kind of things, and then there is the synapses, the link, how one cell connects to another, right? Synapses it's called. And there are chemical transmitters there. So the signal goes through a chemical process, it jumps from one nerve to the next, and in that sense the human body and the brain and everything is connected. So in the same way you can say that the process is like a nerve. That one step is like one cell, and then you have the connection. And the connection is critical because here the signal needs to be jumped from one to another, and it's done by certain kind of chemical transmitters. And if the chemical transmitters somehow get messed up, then what happens?
Well, you go crazy. So mental illnesses, particularly schizophrenia and hallucination or psychotic conditions, the physiological base is typical brain chemistry. If something goes wrong in the transmitting molecules, and then, well, you are looking at a bird, but you see an elephant. Because the system sort of messes up the signals, and that is what creates hallucinations and all these sort of strange. You hear voices and things that have no relevance to the outer world, because the brain starts to create them itself because the chemistry goes sort of crazy. So in the same way, in production processes, if the handovers from one step to another are not working, then the system might go crazy. So I think this is important to know, because most of you are very much concerned about IT and computer systems and control systems. This is exactly where the IT is needed to serve as the information transmitters from one step to the next, and from one process to the next process, and to help coordinate the patient journey throughout the whole thing from the beginning to the end. The more you have different steps, the more they are these handovers or the synapses, and the more easy it is for it to go crazy. So that's, I think, when you think of IT enabled systems, the fundamental question is that in what way would the IT system inform the next step in the process, that what it is supposed to do, when, how, and how is it supposed to register what it has done, so that then the next step knows how the things goes on. So this is an essential functionality that the IT system needs to have. Okay, then central part of the definition of process is that a process is a device that can be operated several times over in a similar way. So this you can repeat it. So if you repeat it in the same way, then you will get the same output. Right. So in that sense, a process is an element of standardization. You must be able to do it in the same way several times over. And if it's very complicated, then obviously the exact repetition becomes successively more difficult. So, Srekant, we had this discussion yesterday about the repetitions and instances with the service machines. Right? So this is the essentially the issue, that you have a service production system like, say, the Tokyo University Hospital for the Emperor. So it is there, it's designed, everything is in place, then it's activated when a customer comes, and then it runs this, and if you have a continuous feed of customers, then it keeps running, but every customer is one instance of the system. But the system is supposed to have some kind of stability and repeatability, so you follow certain kind of things, you use some kind of assets every time.
So there is the structure, and then the instances that, or the what they call the flow units. So the customers that are processed through the system. So there are two things here. In what ways do you have the stability? And then how are the different instances different from each other? Takes us to the next question. But before that, oops. When you talk of processes, then there is a hierarchical structure that goes from the smallest to the biggest. And here again, the conceptual confusion is big, because these words are plain English words that are used in different meanings. But this, I think, is a way we could standardize the thing. The smallest unit is a step. Of course, inside a step, you can say that there are various kind of activities. But nevertheless, say that step is some activity that is undertaken by an individual production resource, typically one person or one machine. So every step has first a setup. You have to set up, sort of prepare a little bit, set that, okay, you have to grab the tool. If I start writing, I have to first sort of see that the paper is here and then take the pen and now I'm ready to go. So all these activities before I'm ready to go are called the setup. And in factory management, the setup of machines is, as you know from mechanical engineering, the setup of machines is a very important part of the whole thing. How do you do the setup? How much time does it take? And how accurately it's done before you start the machines and have them running. So there's a setup, the activity, and then you have some sort of check. And here is the takt time concept comes here. Because to do the activity in manufacturing typically can be measured, so that exactly the amount of time that it takes to go through the step. In services, the time measurement is not that exact. Then we have the concept called workflow. Workflow in the IT world, the term is used a little bit differently when we talk about workflow management and so. But here, with workflow, I mean a situation where you have a production resource that is two or more agents or actors. That do something in a continuous, uninterrupted flow. Surgical procedure would be like that. You have the surgeon and the nurses and the team, and then they start, and then they keep doing, and then they stop. So this would be the workflow. So a number of steps and individuals there, but because it's real-time, continuous, then the coordination can be done in real time. So the people talk to each other and say, okay, let's move on now and give me that. And oh, now we have bleeding. Bring in that extra equipment and so on. So they coordinate the thing in real time. But in a process, it's in this sense different because it's discontinued. And you have the gap, and that something changes, and you move on. So the workflow is, in that sense, this is an illustration of the thing. The workflow is based on an uninterrupted accumulation of value or activities. Communication is real time, and so this is a one flow unit. If you talk about processes, then the thing is split up. And here you have it's like the synopsis in the neural system. That between the first and the second step, something changes. So the actor, you have different persons continuing the work for example, when a shift changes in the factory, you stop the thing and you go for lunch and then you continue after lunch. So the time is sort of cut off. There can be a change of location. If you need to move a patient to a different ward, then there is a discontinuity in terms of location. You change location. Then you can have in surgery, or let's say you have different competencies. You have been first talking with the orthopedist, and then you go to talk with somebody in internal medicine. So the change in the competence or skill set, or it can be change in equipment or whatever. So something changes, something sort of cuts off the flow and creates this gap that needs to be managed. So this is an essential difference between a workflow and a process. But the process is, yeah.
So in workflow, how this each step should be connected?
Good question. Simply because the productive resources are active and online all the time. So you kind of have them in working memory because it's not shut down. So it's a kind of coordination that you do with real-time guidance in a team.
So it's like each actor will be having a particular group and they are parallel and it's connected?
Yeah, they can be that. I mean, it's like team coordination. So you have a surgical team, let's say 4 people. Everybody have their skill set and they know, okay, let's start, and then everybody has their own roles there, which they have learned, and then they adjust it as they go. So the steps sort of are connected. So first you cut up the stomach and then you secure the veins and then you go through this membrane and so on and so forth. So there are steps in the surgical procedure that sort of flow, come continuously because you have the same person, same situation, doing the different kind of things.
No,
well, can have or have not. I mean, typically the surgeon is doing the surgeon's job and the nurse is doing the nurse job and the anesthetician is doing it. So there's an element of additional labor. But the point is that they are sort of seamlessly connected in one situation where they can communicate in real time and interactions in the same way as if you are chief surgeon and have to manage the surgical team, then it's very much social psychology. It's not administration. It's how people talk to each other, how they feel about each other, how they relate, what kind of authority relationships they have. It's teamwork. Like if you play soccer, right? If it's a process, then you have to bring in some element of formalization, documentation, codified information, scheduling, coordination, and all these things. So it turns to management. So from a sort of operations management point of view, I would not wish to go to tell to Devi Shetty that, hey, look, pal, this is how you should manage the things when you operate on the human heart. It's not my business. It's a business of cardiac surgery. And this is what they learn in medical school, how this is to be done and what are the steps involved here. But if you start talking about how do you manage the patient journey of cardiac patients. So Devi Shetty is a clever cookie, so he knows about it, but most cardiac surgeons have no idea. And that is exactly the point where you as a sort of, as an engineer, a management specialist, you can go in and with authority say that I know something about this that you don't know. So you might know everything about managing the surgical team in the operating room, but managing the whole flow of a patient from the beginning to the end is a different thing because there are these handovers, these documentations, these protocols, procedures, IT systems, scheduling issues, flow efficiency issues, resource efficiency issues, etc., etc., which they don't teach you in medical school. Right. So that's one. The process concept turns activities into management, or puts them in a situation where management as a specific skill with specific thinking tools, IT, etc., are needed. If you only do have workflows, then you don't need managers. So it's like my father, a country doctor. He had only workflows. Take one patient case and fix that and get out of here. Next. And then do that next. So, you know, that's it can be done. You don't need a manager. You just need the practitioner. But as soon as you add specialized resources, you have a nurse and a midwife and we have special doctors and all that, then you need, sooner or later you need management to look after these flows and the connections and the follow-ups and the documentation and all that. So typically, I mean, any of you guys have started a company? I've been involved in several startups, so it's funny, so you say if you start a small company with your friends, and then up to a certain size you can manage it without management. So the bookkeeping it's in your wallet, and the office is in your kitchen, and you do things, you know, there are no formats, no procedures. You want to have, you need to have board meetings, but then you write all the papers in before and then please sign here. We had a board meeting yesterday. You were not there, but since we all agree, then no problem whatsoever. Then you, if you grow and you, there are different kind of cutting points that I remember. So the first important cutting points where you hire the first person who is not an owner and not your friend. Why is that? Because if you're a group of friends, then you manage it like a group of friends. Then you take an outsider who is hired and employed, and it is a different kind of relationship, and it's a different problem, situation. And then you start by hiring the first non-friend person, who might also not be an owner or a founder, you start to need human resource management. Because you have to agree upon a salary. And you have to sign an employment contract. And you have to agree on the rules of employment, which are all sort of documents that you don't need as long as your small company is a group of friends. Everybody is a founder and owner, and everybody expects to get rich as it grows. You take salary out of the company if you can. If not, then you don't take it, you know. So the things change. And then you have all these different kind of cutoff points when the group is larger than typically than 7. Social psychology, 7 is the magic number. That's if a group is larger than 7, then it's difficult to have this kind of real-time continuous communication. You can test that next time when you are in the cafeteria. If a group of 7 or more eating lunch together, then what happens is that it's almost impossible to carry a conversation that would involve everybody all the time. So it tends to split up that these two guys start talking about something else, and then here these two guys and the rest in the middle have a third conversation. So 7 is the sort of maximum that you can keep together. So it's nice we have this group of 2 or 3 because they are in that sense intensive. Okay, so this in that sense the concept of process is very fundamental in management, and that's why you need to pay attention to situations where workflows start to split up into processes that start to require management. And the larger the company grows, the more you get these cutoff points, the more information is required, and then sooner or later comes the following cut-up point in the history of your company, when you start to have the first full-time manager. In the small startups, everybody's doing everything, everybody's talking to customers, or everybody's programming or doing this kind of things, and management is something that you do on the side because you have to. But typically if you have, say, 20 people or more, then there's so much management that somebody has to be a full-time manager. And that's a sort of horrible point, because now you have created a bureaucracy. Bureaucracy. Somebody who is full-time bureaucrat, who is not selling, not producing, not doing a productive work, only sort of administrating the thing. But you have to have it. It's absolutely necessary. Management and bureaucracy is necessary because of this specific thing that is related to how work is organized in process. Okay, then one process typically, you say it has a process owner, so there's somebody who is in charge of the different steps of that. Then a multifunctional process means a situation when the sort of flow unit crosses an organizational boundary. And in healthcare that happens. In the patient journey means that you have to go from surgery to ward care, and from there to rehabilitation, and from there to orthopedic care, blah, blah, blah. You cross a boundary. And on each side of the boundary, you have different processes with different process owners. So this creates a new kind of situation where the processes in different organizational units needs to connect. So again, you have the question of synopsis between units, but these are a different character than a synopsis inside the process, because here you have to make the administrative jump from, let's say, the surgery department has its own bosses and managers and professional rules and its own budget. And then this issue moves to some other department that has a different budget, a different boss, different rules. So that creates sort of more complications. And then finally, we can say we have the supply chains, supply networks, and or production systems. And then it means a situation where the flow unit or the patient journey has to cross the boundary between legal entities. So in the multifunctional, you are still within the same corporation, within the same legal entity, it's only different departments. And if the two process owners cannot agree, they have to, can to go to the boss that is boss of them both, and the boss can solve the matter. But when we are talking about the supply chain, then these are independent legal entities. They are limited corporations. There's no boss on top of them. It's only sort of customer, seller and buyer relationships that are managed to contracts. So the contract in the supply chain is a kind of synopsis, but it's different from the company internal agreements in that they are typically formal, they are written down, and they are legally enforceable. Right, you have been doing with supply chains. Is this correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So the contracts has to be typical, and this is the point in the history of your company where you for the first time has to bring in a lawyer. How awful. But that's my experience from dealing with company startups, that typically, I mean, if you don't know what to do, then bring in the lawyers. Most of the time, you know, spending money on lawyers is money well spent. Or would you agree on that? I don't know in the Indian situation, maybe the Indian lawyers are crooks and thieves, but in my part of the world, I mean, if you are not sure about how sort of contractual relationship between different companies should be written and designed, then call in a specialist. And that's simply because when you deal with the different legal entities and corporations, the contracts are serious in the sense that if there is a conflict, then the contract, one of the parties can take the contract, the paper, and go to a court of law and sue you and demand damages or whatever. And because the contract is enforceable, then if a court of law decides that, yeah, this part of the contract has broken the rules of the agreement, so and these are then the punitive damages or others that the court of law says that this has to pay, then you have to pay it. It's sort of legally enforceable. If you don't pay it, they take you to prison. Or the police comes and closes down your shop and confiscates your property and your penalties are paid. So it starts to get sort of deadly serious in a different way than if you just agreed about things between friends. Okay, so to sum it up, the connections between different sort of specialized activities is the core thing in management, in the same way as the neural network in human beings is the core thing that keeps a human being together. Okay, then a few more things about different kind of processes before we close for today. So now we have talked about the sort of the basic definition of a process. It's the bird. Now we start to talk about ducks and pigeons and sparrows and seagulls. So what different kind of processes are there in this world? I think a fundamental typology is this, what is in this picture, namely standard processes, routine processes, and non-routines. A standard process is by definition a process that repeats itself exactly in the same way over a number of times. So every instance triggers a repetition that is equal to the previous and the next one. So you can think here of, say, a copy machine. So you do one setup, you have an original and you put it in the machine, and then you close the lid and then the pressure buttons, you said 15 copies, black and white, single side. Okay, that's a setup, so machine is now set up. You know the electricity on, the paper is there, the ink is there, and then you press the button, boom, and then it starts to operate and it runs for 15 times, it repeats the same cycle. It creates 15 copies of the original. Now, this is the issue where you have the quality, the small quality thing. Are the copies equal to the original or not? If they are not, then you have a quality issue. If they are, then quality is good, right? So this is a standard process with one setup. You activate a large number of repetitions, instances. So that's a copy machine kind of thing. The quality metrics related to standard processes is deviations from target. So the small quality kind of thing. This is what you wanted to do, an exact copy of the original, and this is what you get, something different. Here you have a quality problem. Right. Now then the routine process is different in the sense that you have similar but not identical repetition. So you have different kind of cases coming your way, and then you have these decision-making points, like the red symbols there, where you decide that is this urgent or not urgent, and then if it's not urgent, then what is this? So you have a process with different decision steps that then lead to certain kind of expected outputs following different kind of paths. And this is the typical process in healthcare, because if you are a general practitioner, you sit there in your office and then comes one patient and what's your problem? Stomach. What's your problem? Headache. What's your problem? Broken bone. What's your problem? You know. So they're all different, but they are similar in the sense that there are patients who need medical help. They are similar in the sense that all of them are, they are not animals or aliens, they are human beings who have the human physiology. they are all subject to some sort of basic medicine or some insurance coverage system or whatever. So there are similarities and differences. And in a routine, you can say that the differences can be wide, but they are sort of limited. So as a medical doctor, you treat only human beings, not animals. You treat only human beings who have a medical problem, not necessarily financial problems or marital problems or stuff like that. And within the medical problems, if you're a GP, you treat only sort of non-severe, no, non-urgent things, and so on and so forth. So you have certain kind of selection in what you accept. And if you are skilled and experienced, okay, this is a typical case, then you activate some algorithm in your mind and you do the things and that's it. And then next. So the quality issues here are not necessarily the kind of deviation from target, but it's the do you make the right choice or the right judgment of what is this case that has come your way. Then you have non-routine processes. And these are situations that you find in emergency care or in the police work or in the military, where something happens, you cannot escape, you have to deal with it, but you don't know what it is. You cannot really very well classify it, then you have to start an iterative fact-finding, sense-making process to try to figure out what's going on here. So if you are, say, working for the emergency services and you call out there is an incident somewhere and you come to the scene, then there is a smoke and there are people and there are blood and there are fire and there is this and there is that. It's complete chaos. You don't know what it is. But if you are a trained professional, then you start to figuring out, okay, is this a terrorist act or an accident? Are there victims? Have people died? Is there a fire? Are there explosives, flammable materials? Is there some kind of traffic that needs to be diverted? I mean, a professional person starts to go through a checklist in his brain pretty quickly, and soon they start to sort this out, and the non-routine turns into a routine. If you are a layperson and you've never seen it before, it might take you several hours to figure out what's going on here. But eventually, you obviously will figure it out, but then the damage is done. So in this sense, there are different kind of processes depending on what is the level of control and repeatability that you have here. So it is important to know, because in a hospital you have all these kind of processes. Typically, when you do diagnostics or logistics or supplies, there are standard processes that can be designed and set up and then push the button and they go on. Most of the patient work is various kind of routines. And occasionally you have the non-routine that requires a certain kind of different step things to do. Then, okay, time is up, but I'll go quickly through another thing. Then in process management, the bottleneck concept is important. It has to do with process balance. So if you have different steps, and they have different processing capacity. So if some step has a lower capacity than the others, then it's a bottleneck and then it creates an imbalance following the principle that the chain is as strong as the weakest link. So the bottleneck engineering is this is an important thing because this happens all the time, that production systems are not balanced. You have different capacity, speeds, things. So bottleneck engineering, or it's also known as the theory of constraints, TOC. It's a subset of operations management that we're not going into it, but it's sometimes applied in healthcare with good results. So you need to be aware that these are the things that happen, and the production system can get out of joint because of these kind of imbalances in the flow. So bottleneck is one thing, and maybe we can conclude with this, that when we think of process and process management, there are sort of number of issues that we have to look into. It's the sort of the values, how do they connect, what is created in a process. Then, as I mentioned, there's a sequence. Some processes are path dependent. You absolutely A must come before B, but sometimes your C and D can happen in whatever order. Then there's this core issue about the flow and the handover and the cutoff points. And from that follows then the question of inventories and flow time. Then there's the bottlenecks and related constraints that have to do with the balance. Then there is a that what is the result, what is the output that the process creates. So if you repeat the process in the same way, do you get the same result or not? So what is the sort of stability of? And then the process can also be used as an accounting unit. When you want to know the cost of production, then you have to look what is the cost of this particular process step by step. What are resources consumed and how do they accumulate through this process? Okay, that's a certain instance of process. And then there are a number of ways, sort of graphical tools that are used in order to describe processes from different perspectives. Let's not talk about all of them, but you sort of choose the perspective depending on what you want to get out of there. And this is a blueprint model that is a certain standard way of describing processes. Okay, this is a good point to cut off this step of the process.
Thank you.